Hi, my name is Jermaine West. I'm also a visual artist, but also a multimedia, multidisciplinary artist, clothing designer, proud member of the Westport Artist Collective with Mix. Been painting. I started out, in the form of street art, doing graffiti, and over the years developed a lot of different styles and techniques that represent my art.
Thanks. Well, there's one, I thought I'd start with maybe a legal term first, because this comes up so much, and I don't think anybody really knows what it means, so this goes to Alan first. But I think everybody has some fair use. You know, what is fair use, and how does it work for and against an artist? I create art, how does fair use help me, or could it threaten me somehow?
Both. Fair use is a very misunderstood expression, and I'll give you an example. Some writers, some musicians made the mistake of believing that, take just a line or two or a few paragraphs here, a sentence here and there, nobody will notice, nobody will care, and with a 1,000-page book or a 500-page book with a couple of paragraphs and a song with 30 or 40 or 50 measures or bars, whatever if you want. Big mistake. Fair use is really a legal exemption to the Copyright Act, which allows certain classes of uses of copyrightable, protectable material. And most of the time, the initial question is whether or not the use is for commercial or for scientific or educational use. In other words, Fairfield U would get away with using a mimeographed lesson way before a commercial enterprise would get away with copying something for its own use. If the user is a charitable or educational or nonprofit organization, counts a lot in its favor. It's not the final answer. The news media too, using reporting on today's events. You see on the evening news how the broadcasters will take whole sentences from and paragraphs from the New York Times, Washington Post, and use them, and they do that back and forth. It's almost a given in the news industry. The classic example of overuse of fair use, I think the best case is when Jerry Ford lost the presidency in 1979-80, made a deal with HarperCollins to do his book. The publisher was about to publish the book when Ford's agent had sold magazine rights, exempt rights, to Harper's Magazine. And Harper's Magazine, everybody wanted to know just one thing in Jerry Ford's book. Why did you pardon Nixon? What were the circumstances at that stage? And sure enough, in the magazine article, which appeared about a week before general publication of the book, the magazine article disclosed the big bomb. So Harper's sued, Random House sued HarperCollins, Harper's Magazine, and eventually won. Why? Because even though the use was only of a paragraph or two, it was the heart of the issue. The illustrative case is there's a gentleman named, I think, the great Franchini, who used to get shot out of a cannon. And he would go to these state and county fairs throughout the Midwest, and four police stations showed up. And, you know, his act was over in maybe 8 seconds. Bang, into it, that, they took it. And they claim, no, no, fair use of these. And the court said, no, it was his whole shtick. And that's all he had. So fair use is a very, very, how do I describe it? It uses a lot of different factors to determine whether or not the taking or the use of a song, of written material, of a photographic image, of a visual image of any kind, of characters in a play, whether or not their usage is used for satire or parody, which is another exemption in the fair use doctrine, or whether or not it's used for a purely charitable and educational circumstance, or whether it's taken for an unfair commercial use. So if you're thinking about using all or part of a written or a copyrighted written material, song or text, you really ought to consult a lawyer. Any lawyer knows intellectual property because you can give birth very badly and you can prevent that.
All right, thank you.
Long-winded.
Jermaine down there, because Jermaine's he's an artist and very entrepreneurial. He has a gallery and also do fashions and stuff.
Yes.
So what kind of, in terms of a bit, you know, we're talking about business, so do you have a business model, or are you just kind of flying by the seat of your pants? How do you manage all, you know, the different things you do?
Well, I mean, a little bit of both, because as we know, models, especially nowadays, models are constantly changing. It's like you come up with a business model that may have worked 10 years ago or 5 years ago, or even with the onslaught of the internet and social media, things can change weekly, you know. So even with, you know, marketing and promoting stuff and finding new clients and customers and how to get my business out there, it's constantly changing. You know, I mean, I think most people's model is, you know, make money. try to make money. But then, you know, how you go about, you know, what designs, you know, how you sort of pace your business is sort of constantly changing. I think that's what a lot of artists are seeing, like, nowadays. Like, a lot of the old models are just dissolving. And I think a lot of people are sort of floating and wondering which way to take what they're doing.
And social media figures heavily into what you do.
Yeah, it does. I mean, but a lot of times I think also people are finding out that social media can be a grand illusion too. You know, I mean, a lot of times likes don't necessarily equate to sales or equate to business. I mean, they do in a lot of terms. You know, there's ways to monetize likes also, but you still have to have, you know, I mean, I try to stick to having, like, you know, heels to the ground, grassroots, you know, connection with real people and real relationships that turn into things that are, you know, bigger than just the social media platform.
Okay. So Susie, Susie's a musician, also an artist, and involved in other things, a lot of stuff too, so how do you, I mean, I don't think any of us feel like successes. I mean, we're not here to say, you know, I made it, but how do you navigate the worlds where you're in?
So I came up with a very strange parallel, and I think being an artist is similar to being an athlete, in the sense that you're just donating yourself to all this stuff, no matter what the outcome. You're doing it because you love it, because there's some kind of endorphin rush that comes along with it, right? Elle is agreeing with me. you know, you kind of back it yourself financially until it might pay off or until you find a way to break even. I try to break even, at least. Sometimes it's slightly profitable, but it's hard in this town. Like, there's no way to be profitable enough. But, you know, talking about models that have changed over the years, I actually started out in fashion design. I have a degree in fashion design and textiles, and I just hated the industry, and I never went into it. But years ago, the way to sell fashion was to make a line, and hopefully you had the right size and colorway for everybody. And if it sold, and you made everything, and it all goes away, you're good. You break even, maybe you make a profit. Nowadays, I've ventured into on-demand printing, which I really like, because I can take some of my fiber designs, and turn them into wearable garments or usable items like this bag, my pants, my scarf. So, and then, you know, this is some of my art. This is what I start with. And this happens to be a wearable item too, which I can demonstrate when I have both hands available. But, so I do a lot of different things. And I just look for innovative ways to find jobs that will actually pay. And I think it's also important as a creative to hold strong to your values and know that your creativity has worth. You know, just because you're an artist doesn't mean you're donating your time and your goods for free for every charity or organization. It's good to know that you can be paid to run a workshop or, you know, to provide a service, whether it's a commission or just a piece of work that you've created, right?
Or teach classes. I mean,
that's another thing.
Yeah, I mean, teach classes. In working with the Westport Arts Center, I've been an artist in residence at everything from a charter school to a homeless or a transitional home for homeless veterans to, you know, private classes. I mean, it's just really about, you know, diversifying your portfolio, I guess you could say, you know, and similar to what, you know, Susie does. I brought some.
Can you hold that?
Yeah, hold that. Just like an example of like a painting, or this is like a collage that I've done, and then like a t-shirt that I've done, you know, so if somebody may not have the $500 or $600 for this, but they'll have, you know, $25 for a t-shirt. And I think a lot of artists sometimes may get, you know, sort of stuck in their zone and like, I'm just of this painter or I'm just of that painter and don't see the many options that are out there. And I don't think it's watering down yourself. I mean, especially in, you know, today's society and today's markets, I mean, it's just really, you know, like I said, once again, diversifying what you do. You know, it's not necessarily selling out if you take a fine landscape, you know, painting and put it on a t-shirt and sell.
Wendy's a gallery owner. How long? Well, first, how long has the picture this been around? And then, what have you seen over the years? What changes have you seen in the whole art gallery consumer business?
Well, Picture This has been in Westport for over 30 years. Started first as a custom framing shop, and somewhere along the line, I had enough people, local artists, asking me, could we just hang some of our artwork on the walls? So we started doing that about 25 years ago, and
okay.
We had shows and kept it up. And up until about 2007, I'd say, I had really regular shows every month and a half or so with all local people, and could count on selling maybe 25% of pieces in the show on average. But after the recession, that sort of went away. It became very difficult to sell any pieces. I kept doing shows while I had this space at 606 Post Road, which many of you are familiar with. It had a nice big space for showing art. But it was very expensive, and I wasn't selling very well. So we moved up the road to 772, and still have a great space for custom framing, not so much space for gallery. So I do still show some local art, but I found it very difficult to sell in recent, you know, the past 6-7 years.
So you're relying on framing is pretty much your foundation of the business?
Yes, framing is the majority of the business.
Can you ask questions?
Yeah, sure, yeah.
Why do you think that is?
Courage.
What?
Why do you think that is?
I'm not really sure. I mean, obviously the recession, you know, people were hanging tight to their dollars, but, you know, the recovery has been pretty strong, and there's certainly plenty of people around who have plenty of money, but they don't seem to be as invested in the local my experience with MySpace, and I have two factors in that. There was the economy, and then I moved, so now my space is different. So I don't have the same kind of art shows that I used to have.
So another perspective is Dick Frank is a renowned photographer. What, and you, I don't know if you do still do any corporate work, but how did, what's your model of pursuing photography?
Our model is to make sure that we have three meals a day, and we've been successful at that. Noticing that everyone seems to have a cell phone, and you understand how a selfie works, you've eaten up my business model. I was known as a people photographer, and did magazines, corporate work, and book projects. And I kept fooling him until the Great Recession hit. But before all that, in my delusional state, I went to Ohio University to study photography, and I figured I had to master it pretty damn fast because there was nothing wrong with my feet, but there was a lot wrong with my draft status, and I figured I would be drafted. So there's nothing like motivation when your country's calling, and they called eventually. But I managed to fool them as well and survive that period of time. When I was in graduate school, I learned a couple of things. One was there were a group of, there's a school of thought about being a people photographer. And I heard that school of thought, and I looked at what I was trying to do, and I became what was known as a people photographer. And there was another school of thought, and that was for rocks, trees, and moss, which was the pretty side of life. And I did not fit into the pretty side of life. So I was a people photographer, and I loved it. And I did manage to do magazine work. Now, at this stage, I am a rocks, trees, and moss. I said it years ago with mockery and derision, and now I'm proud of it. And I'm going to start to take a culinary process to my work. I'm going to take the various half dozen projects that I have bodies of work on, and I'm going to take the spaghetti approach, and I'm going to take it and throw it against the wall and see which one sticks. So I'm assuming one of those projects is pretty good.
You think?
I'll keep you posted.
If somebody out there anywhere is not a Dick Frank or an esteemed Larry Silver, is photography, is, and like you said, everyone's got a phone, everyone's can take, you know, there's a zillion pictures taken every day. Is there still opportunities to be like a real photographer out there?
Absolutely. Absolutely. Every day there are new possibilities, whether it's people photography or rocks, trees, and moss. The goal is to raise the bar, to see in a way that other people don't see, and you're an individual. And that's what it's about. It's not about, can I emulate somebody's style? It's about finding your own style and finding your own images, and being proud of the discoveries you make.
I have a question for Alan that people ask me. I, as well as being a photographer, I'm sure you might, you know, I do this lenticular stuff, which is photos that change when you walk by. This is a virtual aquarium. But I also do, you know, to feed my, to have three meals a day or sometimes two, I design websites for people. And I've done, and mostly artists, authors, individuals, you know, I don't do corporate stuff. But they will ask me what, I'm afraid that some, I've literally said, I'm afraid to put my images online because somebody's going to steal them and put them on a t-shirt or make a postcard out of them or a poster. And it has happened, I'm sure, but is there, is that something worth losing sleep over? Or is there anything, you know?
Any visual artist ought to worry about their creative work being pirated. First thing you got to do is, if you've got a body of photographs, oil paintings, watercolors, your work, you got to copyright it. And you don't copyright it by putting a C on it and a circle and leaving it alone for a while. You register it with the copyright office. If you've got a whole bunch of photographs, you can do about up to 75 now, I think. So 70 for one. Also, copyright online, which we're doing now with film and television and in photographs. And it's rather easy for us to do. But the first thing you have to do is just establish that your ownership over anything that's visual, written, or musical, or dramatic, there's a copyright form for it. And you can do it yourself just by dialing up the United States Copyright Office, Library of Congress. You get it over the internet, and every kind of form, and there's an omnibus form now to do it that you use. You put down the author's name, the year that was created, and you register it. Registration is effective the day that you send it in, even though you don't get your registration certificate now for, oh boy, I just got a screenplay back that we registered a year ago, January. We just got the registration last week. So it sometimes takes 13, 14 months. But if you can show that you registered it, and when you do it online, they give you receipts right over the internet. If you can show that you've done it, then you're protected. And it's effective the day that you register. Now, with that said, if you're working the internet and you're going to put your body of work up and they're registered, I mean, your website ought to say copyright Joe Smith, 2018, all rights reserved. You put that at the top of your registration form, and I have artists put it on virtually every piece of artist's piece of work they do. But if it's part of a book, if you say it once, copyright 2018, George Joseph Smith, that's enough to protect you. Now, what happens if somebody rip you off? Of course. I mean, it happens every day. There are commercial services today who, if you give them your images, they will mass scan millions and millions of images that go out in advertising to find somebody who ripped you off. I remember years ago when I represented Connecticut Magazine, we bought a stock photograph from somewhere, from one of the Getty Images, I think it was. And about 3 months after publication, nasty letter from a lawyer in California saying that that's our client's image and yeah, can you do it? He said, sign Getty Images, take it up with them. There are services today who will trace down and check periodically to see whether or not your images or your work or your music has been pirated or infringed.
Actually,
does that answer your question?
Yeah, and actually, there's a do-it-yourself. I don't know how thorough, I think it's pretty thorough. It's called tineye.com, T-I-N-E-Y-E, tineye.com. If you have a often I have a client that will grab an image off the internet and they'll send it to me and say, oh, I want to use this on my home page or something. And I don't know, you know, it doesn't have any watermarks on it or anything, so tineye is free. You call it up, you either drag the image into the tineye window or you give it, you know, you search for it, you know, you navigate to it on your computer, and it will come back, it will search the internet in like 2 seconds and say, we found 8,972 instances of this image. And you scroll through, and ultimately, usually, you'll find that it started as a stock image. It'll say, you know, iStock.com or Getty Images, and then you realize that it's been appropriated and appropriated and reappropriated. Sometimes it doesn't. Sometimes you get few, and it'll be a free, it'll just be an image that somebody's put up there for free. There are those, too. Has anybody had...
Well, I was going to say, it has to be a high-res image in order for somebody to take it and use it.
Yeah, it should be. Some people, have anybody had experience with things being appropriated? Or,
yeah.
It doesn't have to be the opposite. I feel like I'm applying the shows so someone will look at my images.
That's influence.
And then, right?
Yeah, this is a question. Does the poor man copyright hold up?
Does a
poor man copyright? Yeah, have you ever heard the term of just
poor name?
Poor man. So instead of, where you mail it to yourself, or you,
you registered letter to yourself.
And as long as it stands.
Don't do it. Here's what you lose by not registering your images. If you don't register after 3 months after publication, you can sue for infringement. However, you don't get attorney's fees, you don't get punitive, the best you can get is statutory damages. In legal jargon, that's a big difference. So, you, for the price of registration, you're upping the ante on your own behalf considerably. So,
Gloria had a question for
you. On a site called ArtNet or ArtCom, there's a lot of Larry Silver. Posters,
mm-hmm.
all framed nicely, with all different prices, but none of them are Larry. They're all copies, including using his name.
Well, I think I told Larry once I was in a play or something in New York, and I went to a parking garage, and in the cashier's booth, there was the Longshore poster that I knew wasn't Larry because it had some other big name emblazoned on it that overrode the image.
It's all over the world, that particular picture.
But
it sold
at
Staples, it sold at the Kmart, it sold all over, and I don't make a nick on it.
Have you ever tried to pursue,
Well, it's a complicated thing, because many years ago, a poster company bought like 5 or 6 of my images for posters, and I gave them permission to use it, and they published it, and...
royalties.
They continued paying me royalties, but ultimately it was so popular that it started to go. It was a Swedish company. It was in Sweden, and it got very complicated. And then they photographed it. They changed it, and I just stopped pursuing it. But it sold all over the place.
So they changed it enough that it wasn't.
just bad quality. The quality wasn't as good as when it was published in Sweden. The quality was nowhere there.
Right.
But they must have copied that, and then they sell it for different prices and different frames.
It should be a high. Well, if you're stealing, it shouldn't be anything. But if you're going to make a nice poster out of anything, it should be a high-res image. But some people just, will use whatever they can find. I mean, people think because it looks good on their computer that it's a high computer. All images you see on the computer are low res, and if they're to be printed, they look fuzzy and pixelated.
We think the $20 or $49 frame or $69, they don't care.
Yeah,
there's a lot of really bad reproduction, low res or blurry, or I'm sure it's happened to various images that they've just degraded.
Also listed in all these major stores, a lot of them.
Al?
I'm interested in hearing more about the people who make money in the business, like agents, brokers, gallery people. I know it's simplistic, but obviously they have to sell paintings or sell artwork. Is there something they share in their technique, in their drive to make a living, that causes them to be successful? I'm talking about what do they do. How do they enhance, how do they attract the kind of people that can make money for them?
So I was asking, how does an agent or representative enhance, or do they enhance the commerce for an artist? Has anybody here have an agent, or ever had an agent or a representative?
Hi.
No.
officially. I mean, I've had a lot of good friends that had good friends, but yeah. You know, I mean, I'm sort of in the market for you, but
yeah.
Once again, it's almost to me. I don't know. I mean, I go to all the art fairs, and I know a lot of galleries. It still seems like it's always that connect. You know, like,
you're probably doing more for yourself than an agent would.
Yeah. And somebody's on payroll, it's like, well, I'm paying you to do what, you know, I'm sort of doing. But to me, it just seems like somebody that just has that clientele and that just has that can work the magic.
It's who you know.
Yeah.
But you, and Wendy, you sort of act like, whoever's in your gallery, whoever's hanging on your walls, I mean, you become their agent in a sense, right, for that time being?
Yes.
In a way, right?
But I'm not an agent in that I go out actively looking for customers to buy a certain artist's work. But if it's just your agent is. I think you can be your own best agent just by promoting yourself and getting to know as many people as you can. And it's who you know.
When an agent. See something comes through the mail, painting, group of paintings. Are they looking for a charisma? Are they looking for something that is magical? Or are those words just words to them? I mean, it's so simplistic. I mean, they need paintings to make money, but they don't take a painting because for some reason.
So the question is, which is, sort of leads up to the next question. I was going to ask about branding and how each of us, not maybe in a formal way, brand yourself to distinguish yourself in the marketplace. So,
with the advent of the internet, we've had visual and performing artists attain possibilities that could never have been attained 20 or 30 years ago. The clever use of the internet and internet self-help has become a burgeoning industry. Over the last 35 years. But nothing succeeds like the publicity that it may be directed to an individual artist. And that is the conundrum of how to get noticed, how to get publicity so that your work is noticed and accepted into various circles, whether it's literature, whether it's visual art, or music, or performing art of any kind. So I would not, having dealt with my life, my father was a columnist in the entertainment field here in Connecticut for years, I've dealt with public relations and promotional people for years. They're very important. And if you have the means to retain a good PR or marketing person, whether here or the city is another story. But Connecticut has some really good public relations people, some good promotional and marketing people, and they should be talked to. Don't think that your only chance of success is by self-help over the internet or putting up a flyer in the local library. There's other ways you can do it. Now, how expensive will it be? It depends. Some people obviously understand, cannot afford that kind of promotional help. Some can't. Take a look.
Thank you.
I think other than the terrific photographs of Larry Silver and his wonderful success with his body of work, I really have Vivian Mayer in mind, and I think death is the answer, because that's when money dies. So, you know, the closer,
did you go to the show?
Before you close, get over that line, make sure you have everything lined up as to which is your best stuff.
And before the work appears.
Think about what she was able to accomplish, mm-hmm. and she wasn't even looking for fame or fortune or recognition.
Mm-hmm. You could go. I mean, my brother's not here, so he defend himself. But he went for a short time. He went to the stunt version, the stunt path, and he was doing things to get in the Guinness Book of Records and get attention to himself. He drummed for, like, before he became a visual artist, he drummed for 4 weeks in a nightclub. He got in the Guinness Book of Records. Then he made the world's biggest T-shirt. It was like 100 feet long, and he hung it from a skyscraper in New York. And he got publicity. He was interviewed by David Frost. I mean, he got a name out there. And then he sort of capitalized on, I mean, this, I'm not saying this is, you know, this is the other extreme of just getting your name and building a brand. So he built a brand of being out there and weird. But when he did come into art, there was people that knew the name, and he had made connections and whatnot. So I'm curious about brand, you know, and branding, not in the commercial, so much commercial way, but how do you, like, start with Jermaine and work our way down, how do you distinguish,
I mean,
your
so
brand?
Similar, I mean, not maybe not doing stunts and stuff like that, but I mean, just, you know, even how I got into doing art, you know, starting as a street artist, as someone who's just constantly putting their work out there in your face. You know, now street art is really accepted, and, you know, it's sort of the thing now. But, you know, as a lot of people know, in the early 80s, mid-90s, it wasn't as cool, but it was still seen as edgy, and it was still seen as something that was sort of breaking the mold of what a lot of other artists were doing. And then, even within doing that, there were certain circles of even, you know, gallerists and collectors that started collecting a lot of early street artists' art, because they had the vision that it would just be something that they either want to hold on to, or that it would be a bigger thing. I mean, I obviously haven't, you know, climbed the ranks of a Banksy or somebody like that, but there's still that market. You know, there's still that. I think people are looking for, you know, the sensationalism a lot, or just the edginess, or buying into a brand or something that they can really feel is authentic. You know, as much as I think social media is just seems like it's a global thing, I think you still have to make those connections with each individual, and they will support your brand. You know, like, I still have, you know, a lot of diehard people that, you know, buy my T-shirts and buy stuff that have been buying since I was, you know, I started doing stuff like coming out of high school. You know, people that have stuff that I've done 20 years ago, and they're still buying stuff because, for whatever reason, they, you know, identify with the brand, they connect with the message, and they just support it. You know? And then if you can do that 1 million, 2 million times over, then you can make money.
So I never really had a grand plan. I'm just kind of winging it, I guess. Fly by the seat of my pants routine. But as far as branding myself, I've really stayed pretty true to that, because I haven't been doing this for too long. I started it maybe 30 years ago, actually, when I was in fashion design, and I would put tubes on clothing, and I would use it for adornments or closures and little accents and stuff. And then it wasn't until maybe 4 years ago that I decided this could be fine art. So I started doing something different with it, and I was using them in lengths as paint strokes, and then I was using them as pixels or building blocks, and I have sculptural pieces that I do as well. So for me, I've stayed very consistent with this specific medium. Yes, I paint, I draw, I've done a lot of other things. I came up with a stationery line when I was extremely pregnant with my third child, and I did the stationery show at Javits at 37 weeks, and everybody thought I was just gonna blow right then. And that was a really hard reality, because this was in 2007, and email was getting really big, and, you know, sending actual mail wasn't. And so that was dead. That was really hard. And it was hard competing against all these big companies like Hallmark and Avanti, and you know, all these companies that can do four color print cards and laser cut and offset printing, and they're doing it in such high volume that they can make a profit. So I put that aside. The socialites will come out for something else later down the line. But I'm sticking to I'm really trying to diversify the different shows that I apply to and get into. I can do a lot with this as far as fine art or contemporary art or fiber art. So I can be very careful about the types of shows that I target. I don't look for photography shows because this is not that genre. It's not that medium. So I kind of look for different shows like that, and I don't really have to look at this gallery or that gallery in specific. I'm trying to get into different types of shows right now. I just dropped off work at Westfield University yesterday, and they have a nice gallery there, and they're doing a fiber art show. So it's kind of cool to be a part of that. It's a different level. I guess it's a different exposure. I'm probably not going to sell anything there, but it's an opportunity to show to a different audience, and you know, I'll be a part of an artist talk there too. So it's always growing. It's always a different opportunity, and you just kind of pursue these different things that come your way and try to filter out what is right and what isn't. So I've been able to get a little bit more selective with that. And then what else? I mean, I just kind of take jobs that come along. I kind of feel like I'm perpetually in college. I just, you know, I'm always pounding the pavement for different job opportunities, preferably per diem, part-time. I don't really want to be anchored to an office or anything. I can't do that. Right? It's kind of hard.
Mix, so. Question to Al. Al, you awake? I'll give you a hypothetical problem here. Photographer takes a picture in a public place. The picture hangs in a institution, nonprofit institution. It also hangs in a commercial gallery. Somebody purchases the picture. Oh, first of all, can he be held responsible if he hangs it in a show in a public place, nonprofit, by the subject?
Okay. First of all, we're talking about a photograph.
Photograph.
Taken
in a public, a park
of
where
an
everybody.
Actual person.
Right.
Without a photographic release?
Without a photo release, not using it for commercial purposes. It's just hanging in a gallery on an exhibit, let's say an exhibit. Could be a group show.
In film, in television, and in photography.
Could you speak with the microphone, please?
I'm sorry.
Thank you, Art.
Sorry, okay. People who are in public places are fair game for photographs. For use in the news, or for scientific or educational purposes, the photographs can be used. However, when it becomes commercial and the photograph is as iconic as, say, for example, the picture of D-Day with the soldier kissing the nurse
at
Times Square. Yeah, I just said photograph. That was a celebratory photograph that became iconic. It was part of a public display. I know a little bit about the photograph, but there was really no way that the person in that position, either party, would ever be able to.
Let's say a person is recognized. Let's take the picture, like Dorothy Lange's picture of the migrant mother in California.
Yes.
It's an iconic photograph.
Yes.
Let's say that picture hangs in a gallery. Can that woman object to it?
Depends on the circumstances of her agreeing to be photographed at the time. Any photographer who's going to sell a photograph of a person who hasn't signed a release is taking a chance. If the picture is posed, and you're asking somebody to stand or sit or do something in a certain way. And that person says, okay, I will. You take the photograph and leave, and then you sell the photograph. Without having a signed release, you are subjecting yourself to invasion of privacy and misappropriation of your likeness.
I thought that if it's not used for commercial purposes, if somebody's walking on the street in Times Square and you photograph them and you put it into a show, can they say,
Probably not.
The minute
you sell it, it's well, it's just, if he's in a public place, not minding his own business, you can photograph him.
Okay, we have two different things. Okay. Somebody's walking in Times Square, and you take a, what do we call it, a scene de faire photograph of somebody just walking and running, and their presence is incidental to the overall.
No, they're the subject matter. They're the subject.
That's a different subject matter than what we're talking about.
You zoomed in on this one person in Times Square,
yes,
or on a public park.
Right.
You paint the picture. It goes into a museum, exhibition in a museum.
Right.
Are you liable for anything if that person?
Well, if you were paid for it by the museum.
They don't pay for it. They just hang it on the wall. Let's say.
Just hang it on the walls, probably.
The minute you sell it,
when you subject it to a commercial use, without that person's knowing permission, then you are taking a chance that you are misappropriating someone's likeness for commercial use.
But you could
people have sued on that.
You could exhibit it if you're not paid in a museum.
Generally. If somebody, for example, you can't take a surreptitious telegraphic photograph of somebody through their window. There's no permission
public,
there. Okay.
Public place. Public.
Right, but if somebody willingly says, okay, take my photograph, just so that alone, based on those facts alone, probably not actionable. But it becomes an iconic photograph that's sold commercially, or even sold to an educational or a cultural organization, you're running a risk. So it's a long, very long way of saying you've got to be careful when you're taking individual photographs and using them for selling.
I have a question there, Jeff. Here's my situation. My situation is I had filmed in a lab in Miami, Florida, 16mm, 35mm. Inside that lab, there was some kind of collusion going on there. I don't know what it was.
Some kind of collusion.
There was collusion between the Russian lab personnel and somebody who sold stock footage in Miami. I only found out about it because I was watching television one morning, and I see my stock footage, and I say, those are my shots. So I call up the advertising agency that was advertising, and I said, what are you doing with my footage? And they said, well, we kept asking a reputable agent in Miami. I said, who's your reputable agent? Because he's not. I collected on that. But he also got into the lab and cut out a lot of footage within a certain roll of film, be it 35mm or 16mm. I even had 70mm cut in the lab. So every once in a while, I'll see on television, usually in commercials, my footage. I don't know how to go back to that agent and other people who may have gotten that footage, because I'll see a brief shot and I'll say, oh, that's my shot.
How long ago was the footage made?
Over a period of 50 years.
50 years.
Okay.
When
over
did you,
a period.
When did you when did you first learn that it was being used without your permission?
Probably around 2003, 2004.
The statute of limitations is long past.
But he's still using it. So how do I get
like I said, the statute of limitations.
How do I get it?
You waived it.
But I didn't know it was taken, stolen.
When did you first learn?
I learned about it around 2004.
Mm-hmm. Statute of limitation is still running. And it's probably no more than 3 or 4 years after you first learned. Statute on copyright, yeah. I would say no more than 3 years.
But what if he's still using footage, mm-hmm, of mine and he's selling it?
still passed.
It's in the public domain.
This is very specific, personal, so which is.
I had heard years ago that based on the case of Robert Indiana, the love thing, the pop art thing, the word love, the gosh, that they had copyrighted it, and it ended up being on every keychain, you know, tchotchke, and every tourist job. And that they changed the law so that you could retroactively copyright something within 5 years? Is that real, or am I imagining it?
I think you're mistaken as to what you can do retroactively, unless we
look at a 5-year window. That's what I heard at the time.
They may have expanded the statute, but I haven't heard about it. I will. It's usually 3 years. 2 to 3 years. Depending on the circumstances and when you discover it. But even if you don't discover it, there are exceptions in the law as to how far back you can go. Would a reasonable person have policed their work so that they would have found out before bringing a lawsuit? But in your case, sir, it just seems to me that the statute is long.
So how long does it last for still photographs? The same thing?
For still the same, yeah. It's the same for music, the same for text, written text. They don't have a separate statute for photographs and film and artwork, visual work.
I wanted to share another topic for Wendy, because they're interesting, specific, and the artists here are very specific. But how about, like, in your gallery, more traditional artist, as good as they may be, like a landscape artist, you know, it's fairly traditional and isn't going to make headlines with any avant-garde weirdness or new, you know, freshness, but just as a competent, how do they get attention? How does somebody who's they're a fine artist, but they're not creating a spectacle or a scene or making any news?
Well, in my experience, I can always talk about the local art scene for the most part. While I haven't sold a lot of art recently, I do frame an awful lot of art in this town. And there are three reasons for the most that people buy art, I think, and other than investment purposes, and I don't think most of us are talking about investment art. One is that they have a personal connection to the artist or the person who made the artwork. The second is they have a connection to the place where the art is from. They bought it on vacation, or they know the town that it's from. And the third is that it goes with their couch. It's decorative. So I think the best way to for that artist, the competent landscape artist or whatever, to sell their artwork is to network with everybody they know, and find, you could try and go to a gallery in a vacation hotspot and paint. Go to Martha's Vineyard and paint the cliffs and, try and sell there. Or join your local art society and go to the shows like the pop-up gallery here in Westport the other night. And or connect with a local decorator or art consultant who has lots of clients and is going to place your art specifically in the decor and know what the trends are in decor, and what the framing trends are too, and frame your work to be on trend with what people are actually hanging in their homes.
Where's all that? Susie.
No, I was just gonna say, I think interior designers, decorators, stagers, they're probably like an agent, think of it that way, because I think they have a lot of influence over people's buying capacity. I think a lot of people get nervous about investing in art because they feel like they don't know the
provenance behind it? Is it a good investment? Does it match the couch? And, you know, does it have like a good feeling, feng shui in the room? And I think if you have a confidant that you're paying, I suppose, or even a good friend that can verify that and confirm that it is a good idea to go for it, I think that is important for the artist as well. So it's not just branding, it's not building the biggest t-shirt and having the greatest stunts. It's all about the connections and I guess dying too, so.
I can definitely identify. In the last 3 or 4 years, I have been doing a lot of work with interior designers. I mean, it seems like a lot of interior designers have networks that, you know, expand into a lot of different areas. You know, because you're working with, you know, people's personal living space, vacation homes, you know, corporate spaces, and it's. I think it's just, you know, like we're saying, just having the work that can almost morph into, you know, different settings. You know, I think it's just being really versatile. You know, I think sometimes we get stuck in like, this is just what I do, but sometimes just tweaking your work or just switching it up or being able to, you know, apply it in different ways can open up, you know, new doors. Even just working in different color schemes or, you know, things like that can go a long way.
I'm not very good with social media. I don't use it routinely or anything, but I do in my email signature. I have one of my images. I change them up. I try to change them every day or a couple of times a week. And I've probably over the past 5, 3, or 4 years I've been doing that, probably sold 10 pieces just from people saying, where did that image come from? What, you know, and then if they didn't already know, I'd say, well, that's mine. I do this kind of work. And I'd send them, lead them to my website. So that's all sort of serendipitous. I mean, it's not a you know, a planned PR approach or anything. So I think anything and everything works. But the other question I want, which actually that one came up with this, I thought some question is what. First of all, we're talking about success as an artist, but what does success mean to each of you? I mean, there's money, or it could be a combination. You know, money, recognition. Workflow, I mean, just engagement. I mean, do you want to start with what does success mean to you?
We had a couple questions.
Oh, yeah, I'm sorry.
Oh, thank you.
Let's see.
I'm not an artist, I work for an artist, but I've run the business for her. So, what I'm wondering is how do you take something that's so subjective and put a number on it and decide maybe one piece you price it at $200 and decide another one is worth something else? Like, is there a set of criteria that you use to kind of take that subjective thing and make it more objective so you can be fair with your pricing?
Yeah, so it's a question about pricing and being fair. And that you know, I got this experience in galleries or an art show, and actually it was with two photographs. I don't know nobody here, but there was two photographs, and they're almost, you know, people go by size a lot now, and they were pretty much equal in size and, you know, pretty comparable and whatever. They're black and white, and one was $350 and the other one was $2,500. I want to talk about pricing, about just the
difference. Market's going to determine the pricing. If your work is good, you have an exhibit, and you sell your work at a modest number, and you sell out, it's a sweet moment, and then you raise your price. The market is there, and the market will continue to go up while there is an active market for your work until there's a great recession and everything changes, and you got to figure out what the new game is. That's all. And yes, money is critical to fame and anything else that goes with it.
But I mean, success to you, I mean, we all, you know, we need the money to survive. But
I always wanted to be a magazine photographer.
Right.
And I was. And then there were no more magazines. So you gotta bend a bit and figure out what you really want to be as a photographer. And now I'm intrigued by the possibilities of books, because walls are terrific, but there are just so many walls, whereas you get a nice little book, people are going to keep looking at certain pictures again and again, if they're any good, and there's a market.
You know, you say there's no more magazines, and I know, the man who used to run the comics department at the New Yorker, where he gave his book signing here, Bob Mankoff.
Yeah.
He said, you know, cartoonists have the same problem, that there's very few places to send a magazine. However, you go into that, I don't know, the magazine stand in Grand Central, it's floor to ceiling.
Yeah, and you know what it used to be like?
Yeah.
There used to be a lot of those places,
yeah.
And there were tons of magazines.
But there are still tons of magazines. I mean, go into Barnes & Noble, it's just walls of, and where does all that stuff come from?
It's cars and
stuff.
All I can remember is making telephone calls in the days, real telephones, and getting names of people, show up, show the work, you look like you were, the work was interesting that you would be showing, and you look like a relatively nice person. Chances are, I would be working with that person. My classic story is New York Magazine, which was my first main goal when I started out after getting out of the Army and being an assistant. And that was, I wanted to do work there. And I got a recommendation to go see Walter Bernard. He's a wonderful designer and a terrific human being, and he zipped through my portfolio in maybe 30 seconds, and he said, that's really great. Show it to me, show me new work the next time, and let me know what you're up to. That's after walking up four flights, and down four flights, and then having a smile on my face and going, this is great, I'll do that. Yeah, you can give up, but I did it. A month or two later, I called Walter, I went up four flights, came down four flights, great, everything is terrific. And then, we lived in Brooklyn in those days, and I would ask Leona, I'd say, did Walter call today? And she'd say, no, not today. And then I'd go, well, not today. I did my couple of trips. And then periodically, I would still say, well, did Walter call today? He didn't call. One day, we're having lunch, and phone rings. Leona gets it, and she said, I'll get him. And it was Walter. And the real point is, more than anything else, if you believe you have the talent for it, and you keep going back for more abuse, it can work out, and it's a sweet, it's very sweet.
Do you think your persistence actually counted with him? In other words, had you, obviously if you give up, you give up, but from his point of view, he's looking for someone, wouldn't you think, that he knows really wants it, and that
well, that's possible.
He'll be able to count on you?
I eventually, did photograph Carl Sagan. Ran his, in those days it meant a lot to me, a full page bleed, especially when you're first starting out. And and then you can call up and say, Walter, I have this idea. And you give it to him and he'll call you right back. You say, go ahead and do it. It sounds good. Well, that's the kind of relationship I believed in. And then Rupert Murdoch bought the magazine and everyone quit. So that happens. So then you just go about a new plan. Magazines, new opportunities.
But doesn't it make you wonder whether there's just new people? Somebody's got to be filling that magazine.
Oh, you mean no, as far as I was concerned, New York was over for me. It was done. I wanted to work with Walter. That was it. You know?
Sherry?
lots of ideas out there. I mean, my wife is a fine painter, and she's been having a little bit of success with this thing called Sawtooth online, and that worked out fine. So if people look, maybe there'll be other sales as well. But there are always new kinds of venues, you know. You just have to see if it's the right thing, you know. But back to the point about magazines, maybe it's the way the business has changed, but I just don't. I think if you look at Time Magazine, yes, Time Magazine is there. There may be
all four pages are like
exactly, exactly. And how many photographers can live off a small magazine like that? You know.
Yeah, any magazine I've been writing for you.
I mean, when I was doing it actively, I would get calls from the art directors, and they'd say, you know, I want you to go to this location. I had a 10-year relationship with Audubon magazine, and it was with this one writer. And in those days, I thought, well, it was because of the art director, the editor, all sorts of reasons why I would get the work. Before I started getting work there, the design director was a good friend of mine, but it took years, and one time I got called up and I said, Dan, you know, you all take yourselves a little too seriously. There's the buzzers are returning to Hinckley, Ohio this weekend. He said, oh. And 5 minutes later, he said, pack your bag and go.
Yeah.
And that started the 10-year relationship, because they decided they had a sense of humor. But I started working with this one writer, Frank Graham Jr., and we got along really well, and the chemistry was terrific. I found out 10 or more years into the relationship that it was Frank Graham Jr. who used to call Les Lyon, who would get his regular assignments, and he'd say, well, Les, should I call Dick and ask him if he's ready to go on the road to one of these features? And Les Lyon would say, yeah, do that. So my work came from the writer. It always came from different sources, and I didn't know it. And I didn't even know whether Les Lyon, who is sadly he's gone, but he was a rough, tough, terrific editor. And all he would do is give me this grunt of a hello when I see him in the hall of the publication. We had a reason to talk years ago, and I said, look, I just really wanted you to know I appreciated working for your publication. It was a great honor. And he said, well, you were the best. And I was thinking, are you talking to me?
I have a question for Jermaine before we. I was curious how your definition of when you started out, how your definition of success changed, if it did, from maybe currently.
Yes. Well, I mean, obviously having children will change success a lot of ways. I mean, it's just like with the model, with the business model. And also, you know, being in the industry, you know, I mean, not so heavily in the fashion industry or the art industry, but just knowing a lot of what's out there and seeing other people's definition of success and what other people are pursuing compared to their real lives. And a lot of times I think people are just getting it mixed up. Like, you know, they're pursuing these things, but their lives are miserable. They can't sleep. And it's like a lot of sacrifice to obtain a certain, you know, level of success that I think, you know, a lot of people sort of generalize and say, well, that person's successful because they have a lot of money and they have a few houses, you know, coastal houses or whatever, but they're sort of miserable. I mean, not everybody, but, you know, a lot of times that falls into the equation. So I've sort of been trying to avoid that level of success. I mean, for me, if I can do what I love to do, you know, make some good money and just maintain my lifestyle, it's successful. And hopefully, you know, I'll, you know, get that number and people start collecting before I die. And, you know, but it's still just trying to keep everything in perspective. Because, I mean, I know so many stories where people seem to be successful, but they're really miserable. And I would never want to trade that for whatever that success is. That's just my gauge of success.
I have a comment. I think it's appropriate when you talk about what is success and what you want. I had a studio in New York for 40 years. I did a lot of work, a lot of advertising, major magazines, billboards in Times Square, big clients. Took a lot of pictures, but I think after 40 years, there's probably maybe four pictures that I did in those 40 years that I hang on my wall. And when I was a kid photographing in New York at 15, 16, 17 years old, I could take those pictures and I could put them on my wall and I could live with them and still like them. So I think you can divorce making money and your love for your art. It's two different worlds. And I think when I hung up my commercial career in 1999 and continued on my own personal work, there's about maybe 50 pictures that I can live with that I really like. So I think the success is what you've done in your life that you really appreciate. And it's not the money. The money, the checks came in, paid the order, you were great, you bought things. But they give you there's nothing lasting. Money goes and goes, but your images and your pictures live with you your whole life. And I think that's success more than the checks.
Definitely.
That's all I can say about that.
That's good. Measure of success. I mean, you got to pay rent, you got to eat. I mean, there's practical things, but yeah.
In advertising, when you win awards, it doesn't necessarily mean it might be a great ad and you might do great photography or great art direction or whatever it is that was great. But I don't believe that just because you did a great job and the best job that you could do, that you have to think that that's the greatest thing you've ever done.
Yeah.
Just because you got an award.
Well, it's true. If you take either one too seriously, if somebody criticizes your work and you fall apart, and somebody else praises it, and you just joy. I mean, it's just.
I think those 40 years, we did take it seriously, but we stopped taking it seriously.
Because it's a business. It's really been. I mean, of all the pictures I've taken, and all the clients, and ads, and magazines, and billboards, and sides of buses, and all that stuff. Come away with four pictures in 40 years that maybe I can live with. And when I was 16, I can come away with pictures that I still like and they still live.
Yeah, well, that's it. And you never, who knows what will be. Well, any thoughts to future, Alan, where do you see the, is things are getting to be more difficult for artists? You know, there's all this,
there's artists and there's artists, there's graphic, there's visual artists, and there are musical artists and acting artists and good writers. I think the internet has expanded the opportunities for filmmakers, especially if you're writing for film and television. You've got with this advent of streaming today, we're finding that so many more opportunities to sell a screenplay and to produce a good film, a television show, or series, or miniseries. Writers for books and novels, I don't know, it's hard to say. I mean, how long will we have Barnes & Noble as a retail outlet? How long will we have anything but books on demand or electronic or audio books? How long will it be newsstands? There will always be change, version in the next few years, I don't know. It's hard to predict. I do know that in the music field, for example, who's buying CDs anymore? I mean, Spotify has replaced Sam Goody. The opportunities and the challenges for composers of original music and for new groups has just changed 180 degrees over the last 10 or 15 years. The ways of marketing, free music, music up on the internet, again, we go back to the internet, is changing the world. When I started doing entertainment about 40 years ago, when you had a rights deal, say for a film, it was about three lines. It was for television, cable was just coming in, you had and videotape. Remember videotape? Remember videotape sets? That was my favorite. Today, the rights clause for selling a book or a novel is about that long. Between the handheld devices and the new media, the opportunities are enormous, but for who will benefit from those opportunities? I'm not a seer. I can't tell yet, but it'd be interesting to be a young artist today, starting out, and somebody today who's been a veteran in the field, as many here in this room have been. And I've learned a lot.
Well, but the problem is, while the opportunities for distribution are greater, the number of creators has exploded because for a couple of grand, you can go out and buy become a videographer. So there are a lot of bad ones, but they're still there.
Well, you say kids going to college today, when they graduate, there'll be job opportunities that didn't exist when they entered college. I mean, technical, digital. Any last words?
Our son Josh went through Westport Schools, and he had a great first trumpet teacher who was a great cheerleader and a great teacher for Josh. And eventually, Josh went to Juilliard, and he became a classical trumpet performer, worked in Japan, Europe, the United States, and he's loved his career. And today he has a wonderful wife and one of our favorite granddaughters. The other one is also one of our favorite granddaughters. And he has a ramen restaurant up in Washington Heights, and he rarely performs. So that's the state of the creative spirit in our family.
All right.
Our daughter's still alright. And doing well.
Anyone wants to sign off with another thought, and then we'll wrap it up? Real quick one, is there how important is mentoring? Have any of you had mentors that made a big difference, or was it just a lot of different input?
Like us?
Yeah.
Mentoring or being mentored?
Oh, being mentored, yeah.
I'd say my aunt. My mother was big too, because she taught me how to sew and knit. And my aunt, she still teaches. She's a professor of rendering for interior design, and she made it a
actually went to FIT because it was a trade school. It was something you could actually do, turn your desires into a career that actually generated income. So that was good. I turned down RISD because I was scared that you had to go in with that major and come out with that major. And I wasn't sure at age 17 that was right for me. Whereas with FIT, it kind of had that built-in format, which I found attractive. But anyway, she was very essential as far as saying, you're good at this, you should do it. And there's this opportunity and that opportunity. And she kind of explained that fashion design isn't just this. There's a lot of different appendages that come off of it. And I think that's important today to understand. I've got three kids, and I want them to understand their opportunities. I want to understand their potential opportunities that we might not know about right now. That could all change in 4 years or 8 years, like you're saying. So I think it is kind of good to see the trends in the marketplace as far as different careers that are available and how you can make money as a creative. There's a lot out there.
Myself, I was really just thinking, I never had direct mentors. I mean, my mother was probably the most, just the fact that she allowed me to be a crazy young artist, you know, she knew, you know, I was into graffiti. She knew I was, you know, at a young age going back and forth to the city and the Bronx and might be in train tunnels. But she tried to keep me from doing it, but she still sort of just saw that I had the passion and that's what I really wanted to do. She allowed me to spray paint my bedroom. And, you know, and when she could financially support, get me some, you know, supplies and stuff like that. But it was just her just allowing me that freedom to become an artist. And then I always found different ways to pull what I needed from certain people or certain influences to help me, you know, grow what I was doing. But I mean, I would say, you know, my mother and just my family in general. You know, I was never, you know, deterred from being an artist or, you know, it wasn't necessarily a thing for a young black kid, you know, to become at the time, even though, you know, it was there, but it was like, you know, be an artist and try this,